Well, good evening, colleagues, and I think it's my great pleasure to welcome all of you to Agile University Business School, and also to introduce our speaker today, Professor Joyce Liddle from Marseille University, France. Now, I've known Professor Liddle for many years now, and some of you might have read her biography on the invite, but she's a very distinguished academic and very senior academic, and her work is widely known. She is the honorary chair of the joint UK Joint University Council, former chair of the Public Accounts Public Administration Committee, and she has been on the journal advisory boards of numerous journals, most notable being the editor-in-chief of the International Journal of Public Sector Management, which she, I think, led for more than 14 years. Again, her area of research is around public leadership, territorial governance, public entrepreneurship, partnership, networks. Very distinguished scholar and academic, who published numerous papers, and I don't want to embarrass Professor Liddle by citing and giving some numbers, but she has published extensively in terms of academic journal articles, as well as half a dozen books and more than a couple of dozen book chapters. And again, she also has some strong connection with Agile University and with John. She has been editing an annual critical management series on international public management. And again, she has previous experience of both industry as well as working in numerous institutions, not only in the UK, but abroad as well. So I think it's a great pleasure to welcome you to Agile University Business School today. And thank you very much for coming in and speaking today. Her topic today, again, as you would have noticed, was very interesting, and where she wants to examine the very interesting theme around entrepreneurship, public leadership, and innovation. And this idea that public services, if you try to be innovative and entrepreneurial, perhaps it's like a panacea and you're going to solve all the problems. And I suspect she's going to kind of challenge that notion and share her views and perhaps evoke some talk. So, a warm welcome to you again. And before maybe we start, I'll invite John to say a few words for I4P, because again, I'm very thankful to I4P and John to help promote the lecture. So maybe John, if you want to say a few things, please.
This is just so that I squeak. Just two things to say, really. Really pleased that Joyce is here. Her talk comes towards the end of a six-week festival which the university has been hosting, bringing together culture, policy, and health in a festival of ideas. And the idea has been really to have distinguished academics and practitioners talk about their work. We've had drama productions, we've had musical evenings. Tomorrow night we have the launch of an art exhibition reflecting different facets of public policy in the UK as well as internationally. And there are three research institutes in the university. Some of you know them. I won't quiz you on all of them and I won't use the acronyms, but we have one in health, which is the Postgraduate Medical Institute, one in culture, which is the Institute for Cultural Enterprise, and the one that I'm responsible for, which is public policy and professional practice. And in a way, its kind of idea reflects, I think, very much Joyce's work, which is how do you link ideas and policy with the real world of practitioners and those who are experiencing the consequences of those policies. And to add to Paresh's introduction, delighted that Joyce is here, really looking forward to what she's going to have to say. Thank you very much.
Thank you, John. I think you need to go home and go to bed, do you? You sound a bit... okay. Can I move on these slides once I've done my introduction? Thank you. First of all, thank you very much, Paresh, for inviting me, for the Institute, for supporting the work, for my fan club. My friends have come to join me, which is great. And I must say as well, before I start speaking, I've sprained my ankle a couple of weeks ago. So the chair is there, not as a kind of prop entirely, but just in case I kind of feel I'm going to fall over, I'll grab hold of it and have a sit down. But so thanks everybody for coming. And how do I get onto this thing? I'm going to try and be as provocative and controversial tonight as I can be. Okay, so the title then is Researching Public Leadership, Entrepreneurship and Innovation. Now, I've got lots and lots of slides. I'll never get through them all. But If I don't get through them all, I'm leaving a copy of my slides with Paresh, so you can all take them home for bedtime reading. So I'm interested in the examining theoretical assumptions and methodological challenges. Now, as John said earlier, I'm very interested in the, you know, the link between theory, practice and academia and what have you, because I always call myself a kind of, I masquerade as a professor really, because I'm really a policy person who worked in the real world at some point in my career. So that's what I'm going to talk about. Is it down? Yeah, okay. I'm going to talk. The talk will draw on a wide literature, but these are some of the work that I've been involved with John, with other people, just over the last couple of years. But in particular, again, I won't go through them all. But in particular, I have a new chapter coming out in a SAGE handbook on public administration, and I'm drawing on some of the ideas on public value and public governance from that. I've got a new book coming out that Julian actually has got a chapter in on public sector entrepreneurship. I think it's coming out in June or July, I'm not sure. And then just where Dane was at an event we had in Birmingham quite recently, and we've got a special edition of Regions coming out very soon, everything sorted and what have you, for a research network that John and I actually created. I was trying to think on the train, John, how long ago, and I thought, good God, was it that long ago? It's about 8 or 9 years ago. So that's kind of something on urban and regional leadership. So again, I'll draw on these, but you don't have to go and read them all, you know, but you might want to kind of refer to them. So my underlying arguments then for this presentation, I want to convince you, it's a bit small that, isn't it? In the course of this presentation, that the pre-existing views that we have on leadership, entrepreneurship and innovation are based on three false assumptions, in my view. First of all, when people think of the public sector, they think of it as still being very barbarian, top-down, very sort of vertical. And I ask the question, is it? And how does that kind of, what kind of implications does that have for leadership, innovation and entrepreneurship? The second assumption is the world of business always offers good practice models. And I have worked in business. I'm still a company secretary for my son's design business. So I'm really quite interested in the way there's an assumption that everything that's in the commercial world is good and everything in the public sector is bad. And I'm not entirely convinced about that. Assumption three is private sector models are easily adapted to public sector worlds. And I ask the question, are they? Because I'm not entirely convinced. So I want to argue in the next hour or so that emulating or importing good practice from the commercial and business worlds might be a mistake given the global financial meltdown and the continuing market volatility. So the idea that you can just take models and transplant them into the public sector might be a flawed way of looking at the world. So this is what I want to do, look at some of the context, the changing context and the new logics of public services, public service management, some outdated, in my view, leadership models, current research into public sector leadership, what we mean by public sector entrepreneurship and innovation, and then if we have, well, I'm sure we will have time because I'll cut some slides out so that we do have time for some questions and answers. Well, you give me some questions, I might not give you the answers, but I'll try. So when we look at, over time, public sector, when I was a civil servant many years ago, when I was a girl, we considered public sector as very traditional. You know, it's very hierarchical, very bureaucratic, very barbarian, very top-down. Over the last 20 years, since about 1980s onwards, we had the introduction of new public management. Everything was about targets, everything was about, measuring, emulating the private sector, what have. This is where we are now. Well, we think we are now, in terms of, you know, creating public value management and new public governance. Now, you could argue that we haven't really moved on entirely from the two earlier kind of models because there's a kind of a merger of the different models. But this is just a kind of a graphic description for me in my head as to where I think we're kind of moving from to. Goodness knows where we're going to go next. As Pete was telling me earlier, we might not have local government in the future. So there you go. Now then, you don't need to see the detail on this. You probably can't read it, actually. But this is some work that's recently been done by Jean Hartley and John Bennington, where they say that we're moving from a top-down, mechanistic view of public services, which was based on, you know, a manufacturing model where, you know, we were all, well, the system was all about cogs in a machine and outputs and that kind of thing. And the kind of models that we based that on were Weberian, rigid, you know, top-down, etc. I've said that earlier. But now, because there's a lot of literature written about co-producing services in collaboration with citizens, we now have to rethink the kind of underpinning theories that we look at. So we now have to think, so lots of people are starting to look at models drawn from biology, from ecology, from neuroscience, from systems thinking, etc., etc. So we're starting to look at public services more about evolving entities rather than just like a manufacturing model. And again, you know, you can go away and read Hartley and Bennington and various other people who are sort of developing these ideas. Because the key thing now is, what is public value? What do we mean by public value? How do public services add value? By public value, the work of Mark Moore has been very influential here, where you bring public value to a whole range of stakeholders, to, you know, the users, to the citizens, to wider society, to politics, to you name it, what have you. And again, his work's been very, very influential, and John Bennington, the guy I mentioned earlier, has been very influenced by Mark Moore's work as well. Mark Moore is a professor at Harvard Business School. Or he was, I think he might be an emeritus now. Another model that I think is really quite interesting is how, again, this is Hartley, not Bennington and Hartley, Hartley herself. What they've done is they've drawn on Michael Porter's work on supply chains, value chains, supply value chains, and tried to kind of adapt it into a more public sector world. And they've come up with this model of public value stream analysis. And in theory, what it means is, if you look at all the processes internally to public organisations and you look at all the processes externally, how do you then add value to every particular process in that value chain? So it's called the public value stream analysis, and the bit at the bottom is just basically drawn from Michael Porter's work. How do you ensure that you look at intangible as well as tangible assets? How do you... How do you sort of capitalise on everything about an organisation, including design, human resources, the things that you can't readily see? And again, these are I'm using this to show you how we think about public services more as a process now, rather than as a top-down, you know, producing products and giving them to the citizens, etc. And this this model, this supply chain model, links therefore into a much wider innovation ecosystem. So we don't just think about products being, you know, given out to public to the citizens. You have to start thinking about public services and public value in terms of how it links in to the whole of wider society. That's effectively what this model is saying. Now then, turning to leadership then. When we think about who is a leader, there they all are. The tried and tested, not many women among them, but there you go. I'll come to that later. When we think about leaders, we tend to think about charismatic heroes, male, not many women there. And you can have leaders from politics. We've even got Princess Diana in there, I think, somewhere. You know, politics, business, you name it. Third sector, what have you. That's our traditional view of what it is to be a leader. Again, historically, if you look at leadership research historically, I'm talking here about a very narrow management sub-discipline of leadership studies. Historically, and this is just my interpretation of it, from the 1930s onwards, the great man theory, not many women in there, no great women theory. We moved into the 1960s, which was actually very then influenced by sociology, psychology, what have you, where leaders were identified by the kind of traits they had, the kind of behaviours they had, etc. Into the 1970s, lots of work in politics, public administration, sociology on situational leadership, contingent leadership. Then through the 1980s, I mean, I might have the dates might kind of over, you know, sort of overlap here, there. 1980s transactional leadership, the kind of carrot and stick approach to leadership, you know, you have leaders and you have followers. Then into the 1990s and onwards, transformational leadership, people who can change the entire culture of an organisation. Since the 2000s onwards, I'll show you in the next slide, there's a massive, massive literature now developing on adaptive leadership, reflective, distributive, collective, you name it, etc. And interesting now, lots of research, but ours is at the bottom, but at the top there, leadership of social movements. Certainly there's a lot of literature starting to develop on things like, you know, the Arab Spring and how people sort of use the web and, social media to lead, if you like. And there's another literature developing on toxic leadership. In other words, people who get into positions of power in organisations could equally be pathological murderers. You know, there's a lot of research on there. And then it comes to the bit at the bottom that John and I are involved in. We developed this research network a few years ago because we were interested in how you can identify what leadership means within urban and regional settings. So is that different to the kind of traditional traits of great men and all that kind of thing? So two key questions we were asking at the beginning. How to explore leadership within varied contexts spatially, in different spaces, different places, and relate the varieties of leadership with variegated, diversified experiences. Now, this is very difficult to research. It's very difficult to even conceptualise, but I'll tell you how we're trying to do that later on. What shapes spatial leadership, and how do people in particular places draw on resources? How do they garner people to work with them? How do they work in partnerships? Role of higher authority. There's a whole range of different questions rather than answers. But they were the two things that kind of drove what we were trying to come to. When you research leadership, when you start looking at it, and you look in the books and what have you, you'll find that thousands, if not more definitions of what it is, what leadership is. Topic of research and debate for centuries, not just for tens of years, for centuries, but no agreement on how to define it. 201 million web pages on leadership and 6 million books. So it's obviously a very interesting topic, but yet we can't agree on it. But what I find interesting is if you read all this stuff and if you go on the web and what have you, no real evidence whatsoever that leadership makes any difference at all to performance. Because what happens is you tend to get people's war stories, how I turned the company around, how I made my 25 million, etc. But you can't disentangle what the variables were that led to performance. So just because you get a top man in or a top woman in, and then the company or the organisation performs better, you can make an assumption that it was bringing a person in, but it might have been something completely different. So there's no real evidence. This is a quote from Paul Benoith. John, you know Paul Benoith. I should have cited him there, but anyway. Retrospective analyses that introduce superficial causal links between performance and leadership practices. Lots of stories of success. How I turned the organisation around, that's my bit, not his. So we do a lot of retrospective analysis of leadership, but we really can't make the, with clarity, determine what it was that led to performance. Based on heroic leaders, mainly men in their traits, characteristics, behaviours, etc. Yeah, I sound like a rampant feminist here, don't I? Anyway, so researching leadership, I am a bit. Oversimplification of patterns in interactions between leaders. We're trying to think about it now. The hidden aspects of power. Very little is written on hidden aspects of power, apart from Stephen Luke's and various stuff on political science, and that's where I'm coming from, a political science background. We need to think of the systemic nature rather than personal characteristics of leadership. However, we need to acknowledge the need for catalysts. This is taken from Rosabeth Moss-Cantor a while ago, actually. We need people who can catalyse change, people who can conceptualise and think things through, people who are connection makers within the system and people who can make sense of situations. So my view is very much a kind of broader view of leadership within context. It's a shared process of path dependency. You've got to be aware of history, developing networks, and how trust is built up. So leadership, as far as myself and our colleagues are concerned, is a socially embedded process. And we tend to see leadership as based on an organisation, man, woman with characteristics, where in actual fact leadership is a process that's embedded in the social world. Current research on leadership has too much linearity and dependence on this superhero, again, as I said earlier. When we look at management research, the field of management research, I've got politics in big red there because that's my favourite topic and I'm a political scientist anyway. But if you think about how leadership's been studied in the past, it's usually been in HRM and leadership, particular leadership studies. What I'm arguing for, and if you look at the special edition that's coming out in June, that we need to have more from the various influences of social science research as well as from management research. So I've put in green there geography, because the geography research is kind of influencing a lot of this work at the moment. And of course, very important there, public administration, public sector management. But within all of these fields and even more, and Dale will be glad to Dane. Is it Dale or Dale? I'll get it right in a minute. Danish bacon. Dane was along at a thing in Birmingham. You see, I presented these two slides and I was going to bring them along. And I thought, oh, they'll go do lally if I put those up. So I've got more thinking on this to do. But the important thing to take from this is, you know, leadership generally has been, I think, located in a very small sub-discipline of management, when in actual fact, the disciplines of social sciences are equally as important, if not more so. And you could go in each of those ones and find that there are elements of leadership research going on. When we think of public leadership, there are three main forms of public leadership. Civic, the civic world, i.e., you know, not just civil society, but universities, the media, we include lots of groups within there. Political, and the bureaucratic and administrative. Or you could have a combination of all three. Included as well, if you want to, you could have managerial leadership, professional leadership, technocratic leadership. So there is a massive multidisciplinary literature, but it's all very contradictory and confusing, and we're all talking about various aspects of leadership within the political world. And, you know, you read people's, you know, when I was the Chancellor of the Exchequer, or how I turned the country round, or what have you. That's what I call about, you know, they would be your political war stories and what have you. So when what we're interested in our research network is public leadership in its broadest sense, how it works out in particular places. Again, because I'm at heart a public administrator, having been a civil servant for a number of years in my past, when we think about public administration, we're only thinking about three things. You don't need to bother too much about the detail on there. Structures, processes, and people. My first lecture as an undergraduate student at the University of Durham on public administration and politics was, what is public administration? Well, it is structures, processes, and people. That's it. End of. So this leads us to sort of think about, you know, which structures are we talking about? How do we analyse them? Where do we get the entrance into the, you know, accessing the data? Processes, what kind of processes are we thinking about? And the people, do we concentrate on individuals? Do we concentrate on partnerships? Do we concentrate on companies? Who do we kind of concentrate on? Again, you know, I won't go through the detail of my thinking, but just to think, when you think about public administration, we're only thinking about structures, processes, and people in simple form. Now, what's happened here? Oop, there we go. When you think about how leadership has been influenced by, certainly from work from my world, these are just a few of them. I'm not talking about leadership studies as a sub-discipline. I'm talking about how the world of political science has contained a lot of work on leadership, but it actually hasn't been categorised or conceptualised as leadership. So we've got the work there of Hunter in the States when he looked at how people make decisions in society. We've got the work of C. Wright Mills, who looked at how people in the military, in the world of corporations, in governments, how they, you know, influence their leadership. Classic elite theory from Mosca Pareto, how a selected group of intellectually superior people make decisions on behalf of the masses. Oligarchy, Michel's, elite spending time maintaining their positions. Dahl's work on who governs, where does power lie, and Weber's theory of authority, charismatic authority, traditional authority, legal authority. Again, I mean, the field is just absolutely huge, but I'm just trying to restrict it to my world, which is, you know, the world of political science. So up until the 1990s then, research into leadership was unremarkable and methodologically disappointing, in my view, and in the view of others as well. Findings had limited utility, and some researchers believed that the concept should be abandoned altogether. That was a guy, what was he called? Bryman. Bryman did a lot of work on leadership research, and he said, well, let's just ditch it all together, because none of us can agree. We've got 201 million pages, we've got on the web, we've got six, God knows how many books, you know. Most research at that time was quantitative. So it was about social psychologists analysing leaders, the kind of behaviours, the traits they had, etc. And a lot of it was based on experimental design, rather than sociologists or organisational theorists. People tend to keep sociologists, political scientists out of this because psychologists know what they're doing. Since the 1990s, there's been a change in thought in terms of more improved measurement and analytical techniques, greater use of meta-analysis and systemic review of the evidence, a huge interest in transformational leadership, you know, how you can change the whole culture of an organisation or of a place or what have you. But leadership research is still dominated by questionnaires. If you look at even cross-cultural research on leadership, what people do is they look at one organisation in Japan, and look at one organisation in the States, and then look at one organisation somewhere else in the world, and they administer lots and lots of questionnaires. And then they come up with all these fancy kind of graphs and things to say that's what leadership is about. There's been a lot of, there are some better cross-cultural studies, but there's been a call for more qualitative research, because quantitative on its own isn't going to get you very far, interesting though your stats are and your data are, etc. The traditional ways, again, had problems: which variables to use, which traits to concentrate on, which characteristics to concentrate on. How do you identify cause and effect? Going to what I was saying earlier, you know, there's no evidence at all that if you bring a top flight leader in, that the organisation is then going to perform better. Or even if it does, that the variable that you were measuring was that person's intervention, because we can't always make that causal link. And there are a number of different variables people have tried to use, like the age of the leader, the rank, the income, the education, political choices, etc., etc. So, because psychologists have dominated the leadership research in leadership studies, they've been trying over and over again, which is why there are all these millions of books, to try and broaden out the kind of variables that they use, and going around in circles and getting nowhere fast. So we need more innovative methods of researching leadership to move on from quantitative methods, but also we've also got caught up a lot on case study, looking at a case study of people who are leaders in a particular locality, or looking at critical incidences. So you do a historical analysis of, you know, when a certain leader came into an organisation, when a certain person made certain decisions. It's what we call critical incidences. Now, again, I don't expect you to kind of read all this lot here, but now there's a lot more new innovative ways of trying to analyse this phenomenon that we refer to as leadership. And just a few of them there, U theory, that's where you get groups of people coming together and measuring the leader, leadership, etc. Appreciative inquiry, focus groups, you name it. Again, these are just, that's just my brain splurge of a lot that I've read about. But the important thing to take from this is that we are moving away from the quantitative and much more into thinking about the qualitative methods. Just a few... Oh, yeah, this is just taken from some of the geography literature. Again, you don't need to read it all, but just the things that are in red there. This is from various geographers, economists, political scientists, what have you. Central and local state provide leadership and direction within a series of complex, formal and informal overlapping networks. So the world of public services now and the world of urban and regional change and transformation is about networks, interconnecting networks. Connectivity, multiple spatial forms, you'll read these in any geography work. Economic, social, economic institutions, social interactions, political shape, politics shape development, and on it goes. One of the things that our group's trying to do is whether we can identify whether leadership can fill this ephemeral gap. We've got all of this kind of networks going on. We've got all this formal connections, informal connections, spaces between the interactions. And can leadership be the missing ingredient within spaces to explain why some urban and regional places prosper and some, like mine in the northeast, he said I was from Aix-Marseille, as you can tell from my accent. I'm actually from Durham, really, but have been in France for 3 years. But in my part of the world in the northeast, which is a declining area, you could ask the question, and that's what my PhD was about, actually, a long time ago. I've had these thoughts for like 20, 30 years, you know, I don't know, just going mad, I think. But, you know, what is it that explains why some places become prosperous and some places don't? And could leadership be one of those things that might contribute to that or not? So are we talking here about a new paradigm? God, you can't read that. I can't even read that. I need my new specs on. My other specs on. I can't read that. So we need to understand power and influence. We need to think about various stakeholders and creating public value. The importance of history, I've mentioned. Combining processes and outcomes. Think about processes rather than vertical. How to research social embeddedness. How do you research social embeddedness? How do you find out about the historical path dependency? And we need to, in my view, we need to move leadership research away from organisationally specific and based on individual leaders. And I think I've said the rest as well. So I'm making a plea that we move leadership research from the psychological, quantitative, behavioural traits of key people into a much broader kind of way of looking at the world. And in future then, I'm going to turn to innovation shortly. I can't even read that either. God, these slides are small, aren't they? So we need to think more systematically, and we also need to think more systemically. We need to think of the system rather than just individual organisations. We could think about processes and outcomes I've mentioned. Thinking about doing research over a long period of time, so longitudinal research to capture the temporal aspects and history of how places, bear in mind I'm interested in how places prosper or don't. Do we need to think about comparative research on individuals, on organisations, on networks, on projects, on collaborations? That's just a question I'm throwing out. We need to think about looking at knowledge and innovation systems and how you capture the formal as well as the informal aspects of influence and power. How capacities are built up over time and how places are influenced by socioeconomic and political models. And the links between institutions, governance structures and people. Now, I don't claim to be responsible for all of these. This is from our research group. And we have a great guy called Marku Sotaratu, who's a lot younger than me, professor in Finland. And he's a real star, isn't he, John? I mean, he was a professor at about 32, wasn't he? And some of these ideas are his. How do you identify who the leaders are? But what we do in traditional research on leadership is we pre-select who the leaders are. What Marku's saying is we need to do research that allows leadership to emerge within context rather than saying, that's an identifiable leader, that's an identified person who can wield power. Do they make a difference and how? Is it an illusion that leaders shape and design places? That was the discussion we had in Birmingham a few months ago. How are strategies developed, resources deployed, and power systems developed? This is work that we don't understand. We don't know how these leadership systems work. And how do leaders learn to be leaders? How do they get into positions and learn to drive change? And again, the formal and informal. So these are the questions we're all coming to Aix-en-Provence in September to further discuss. I'm on organising that at the moment. One way that I've thought that we could do that was to look at some work from a long time ago by F.W. Riggs, which he called the prismatic ecology theory of public administration. It was about measuring different public administration systems around the world, but it was effectively a social transformational model. And again, the reason why I like Riggs's work is because he concentrated on structures, processes, and people, because he was talking about public administration. I don't have time to go too much into that theory. But just in terms of finishing this little bit off before I go into innovation, what we need to do is, in urban and regional leadership research, we need to look at a whole range of different theories, try and draw from the best ones and merge them if we can, and either arrive at an amalgam of different leadership ways of looking at the world. We also need to think much more about our methodological design and our research methods that we use, move away from case studies, move away from questionnaires, think of some of those innovative ones I was mentioning earlier, try and identify what the critical variables are for investigation, and look for patterns of correlation rather than causation. Because that's why we've been caught up on this psychological view of the world and this quant's view of the world, because we're looking for causality rather than correlation. And we need to also acknowledge causal inferences. So for me, Riggs is a very interesting model on that. But if we don't do this, we're going to be in danger of collecting more and more case studies of leaders, but lacking a strong theoretical and methodological basis to why we're doing what we're doing and what we actually mean by leadership in this particular context. Now, I think the tradition of leadership research, I'm not saying there's anything wrong with it. I'm just saying that we've got these millions of books, millions of web pages, but yet just more and more of the same, rather than thinking outside of the box and thinking, can we think about leadership in different ways? So we need to acknowledge that our research differs from previous leadership research, which was organisationally bounded and focused on the individual leader. It may have flaws, as indeed all qualitative research has, but should not negate current and future research. So that's where we are with our research network. We've got colleagues from Australia, from the States, from Finland, from Switzerland, from all over Europe, actually. And we're just discussing these issues, so we don't have any answers yet. So moving on then quickly to leading entrepreneurship and innovation and design in the public sector. Having said what I've said about leadership, I'm going to try and think about what we mean by leading innovation, leading entrepreneurship. Somebody told me in Newcastle a few months ago when I did a similar thing to this. He said, why are you talking about entrepreneurship? It's got nothing to do with the public sector. I said, well, actually, I'm editing a book on it, so it must have something to do with something else. He says, you need to talk about innovation, not entrepreneurship. It means nothing. I thought, okay. Well, I think it does, actually, because I think you can find innovation, entrepreneurship and design in every sector of society. It isn't just related to small business. Alan Sutton's going to say to me, what a lot of rubbish. No, I'm sorry, I'm joking, Alan. Anyway, historically then, if we look at the public services, historically, this is just my interpretation of some of the things, not all of them, some of the things have led us to where we are now. So, in the 80s, 70s, no, I think it was later than that, we had the reinventing government theories of the state, coming from the States. We then started in the 1970s, 80s, trying to reduce government. There was a lot around at the time about re-engineering, business process re-engineering, reimagining the state. Lots of quality models at the time. I remember distinctly being in the Northeast and Nissan moved a big factory into the Northeast, and they had all their quality circles and their, you know, quality this, that and the other and all that kind of stuff. And I think, this is just Joyce Liddle thinking outside the box, I think that a lot of what was happening in manufacturing at the time on TQM, quality circles, percolated through to the public services. So the kind of ideas that were prevalent in manufacturing started to percolate into the public sector. Then we had market testing, best value, better government, total place, not exactly following on from each other, but privatisation, PPPs, PFIs, innovative solutions to social problems, lean manufacturing then reared its ugly head in the business school I worked in Nottingham, and Pete still works in. Is your man still doing his lean stuff? Well, there you go. I'm sure lean has a very important place in society, but maybe not in education, I don't know. Then we had new public management through to what I was saying earlier. Lots of talk now about co-production, services being delivered in collaboration, and again, transforming places. Porter was very influential in all that kind of thing, plus many others that I've forgotten about. So why is innovation really important in this area then? Pollitt in 2012 urged scholars to start developing multidisciplinary explanatory frameworks to explain innovation and entrepreneurship in the public sector, and particularly how it's embedded in daily routines, rituals and practices. He says we've got to start, you know, taking away the sort of nonsense and get down into the nitty-gritty of what people do on a daily basis. A key problem, of course, if you work in the public sector, and many of you might, is that research and practice becomes locked in to what you do every day. And you never have the time to stand back and look back and think, well, was I innovative there? Was I entrepreneurial? Did I do something different? How did I do something different? But there is a lot of evidence of the public services being very innovative and very entrepreneurial. But the problem is we haven't got a massive literature on that. We've got massive literature on, you know, entrepreneurship in small business, entrepreneurship in entrepreneurship. But we don't have leadership. The leadership research in public sector is just starting to grow now in Europe. In the States, it's all about, you know, public affairs and, you know, political leaders and urban leaders and what have you. So there's lots of evidence of being equally as innovative, if not more so, than people in the commercial world. Lots of examples there, won't go through it, but you can pick up any article, any journal, and it'll be about rural entrepreneurship, enterprising cities, enterprising regions, you name it, you know, enterprising creative cities, etc., etc. Again, don't have time to go into them all, but you'll find lots of examples there. Public sector innovation is defined by the Oslo Manual on Public Innovation as the implementation of new or significantly improved products, services or processes, a new marketing or organisational method, a new business practice, etc. But the key to all these new things is it must be novel. It must be novel, it must be implementable, not just an idea. And it must have an impact and add to public results, so add to public value. And again, down the side there in the green, you could think of innovation in a number of different ways in the public sector, different concepts, different technologies, techniques, you name it. I'll give you some examples later. Again, the EU Lisbon strategy, which is 16 years old now, and this is in the light of what's happening with the EU and the referendum, is going to be interesting after June the 23rd, to make the EU the most dynamic and competitive knowledge-based economy in the world for sustainable growth, better jobs, social cohesion, and respect for the environment. And the main driver for economic change is innovation. Excuse me. According to the Lisbon strategy. Now, that's all up in the air at the moment because, you know, if we get a kind of, you know, a withdrawal vote in England, in the UK, we're not going to be part of it, really. But I'm not sure it's worked, actually. But you see all these statements about innovation is going to be the thing that will drive the change process. Another one, just one final one, an OECD report, which actually I was in Newcastle when they came and announced this. You know, they were saying Newcastle was a model of innovative practice. The fact that we've got unemployment in the up in the sky and all that kind of thing. So you get a lot of these, you know, sort of statements. But European regions need different mindsets, new slogans of growth, new stories of success, and different recipes, different strategies for different regions. So there has to be, regions have to, or places, have to look at how they bring together their various strategies, innovative strategies to drive change. Why do you need to innovate? Obviously, there's a list there, you know. Be more creative, attract high-quality creative managers, be competitive, manage, you know, more for less, all that kind of stuff that we hear in the public sector. But it's a concept, but it's not a concrete entity. Again, so there's no real agreement on what we mean by it. We see it mainly as a private sector kind of thing, and we're adapting it into the public sector. And across the world, every government across the world is creating innovation hubs. In France, they go and do Lally. They've got them all over the place because it's seen as a good thing to be innovative and share practice and share good ideas. But it's not new because we have 50 years of government innovation, if not longer. As I said earlier, in the 1970s onwards, there was a way of thinking about, you know, we need to reinvent government, we need to have more entrepreneurial government, and again, we have to use IT and the web more innovatively. So there's been a massive growth in the literature in order to think about how you can be more innovative to add public value. It's about improving decisions we make on health, wealth, happiness. It's about, you know, bringing about transformation, etc. It's not entirely exclusive to the private sector, because when you talk to civil servants now, you could equally be talking to people from the, you know, from ICI or a large private company. Who owns? This is interesting. Who owns the property rights? If you bring in a new innovation, if you're an entrepreneur and you create a new product, you take out you go to the patent office and you say, "I've got a new product here." That's what my son does, and you protect your, you know, you protect your worldwide rights on it, because everything that happens mostly in the public sector is a collaborative effort. Who owns the property rights? Who owns the rights of something when you change things? So I think that's quite important. But of course, innovation's been very much accelerated by fiscal austerity. And I look forward to reading the book on the train that Pete's just given me as a gift on austerity. I should read that. Me and him are just anoraks, complete anoraks. We're the only people in the world who buys that kind of thing. He took it on holiday. I mean, we're mad. So we need smarter interventions and different outcomes and impact, etc. But innovation, again, you can't just see innovation in the public sector world in terms of looking at one individual or looking at a key change. You have to think about the institutional environment within which innovation takes place. So learning, sharing, you know, developing new innovations has to be a collaborative thing within a new knowledge economy. Walker in 2000 said, we need to think about the changing boundary relationships between the public sector, the private sector, the civic sector, and how state agents, you know, local government, health service, civil servants, how they interact with external partners. If you want to think about innovation, you need to think about the externalities as well. So governments can play an important role in providing the framework for innovation. And I'll say a little bit more of that later, because they need to be aware of the networks within which public management takes place. Government agencies can no longer make decisions based on one, maybe they never did, based on one agency being able to solve problems. I use the excuse, the example of this in France with the students. I say, you know, what about, who's going to solve the immigration problem? They go, oh, well, the border police. No. Which of the European leaders are going to solve this? And they go, I say, well, this is an example of the fact that no one agency can solve all these problems, whether it be terrorism, you know, Brussels this morning, whether it's crime, climate change, etc. So governments must decide which interventions they use, which policy tools are appropriate, which techniques, and how you reframe problems. If we're thinking about innovation, we need to think about how we reframe problems and not do them as we did them traditionally. How can governments interact with various partners, the role of politicians, etc. Government still has legitimacy, currently. Whether it will in the future, I don't know. So accountability. Julie and I were talking earlier about some work you're doing on accountability. At the moment, we still live within representative democracy, so therefore the state has a representative accountability. And again, I've mentioned that, so I won't go through it, but you know, how do you create networks for innovation? Who takes the lead? Who has the responsibility? How do you operate the networks, etc.? So linking capacities within a milieu of innovation, where do ideas come from in a public sector world? How do they flow? How do ideas flow? How do you build trust and social capital to develop innovation? And how can they link in with the external world, as I've said? If you think about what I was saying earlier about wider innovation ecosystem, how do you link all those intangible assets within the public services, within a broader innovation system? You need people who can span the different boundaries in terms of linking people, ideas, resources, and building networks. If we look at the NHS very quickly as an example, public sector workers are more likely than their private sector counterparts to be employed in knowledge-intensive industries. Most of them are qualified to master's degree, and tasks are generally knowledge-intensive. But what happens is they get locked into the system. So public services are knowledge economy industries. Health service in the UK, somebody, I don't know who it is, I can't remember, has estimated that £50 billion is locked into intangible assets. Again, I won't go through the whole detail at the bottom, but how do you develop new products in the health service? Who decides on bringing in a new, bringing in a new heart monitor? Who decides to kind of reorganise the whole, appointment system, etc., etc.? So everything that happens within the public sector is about knowledge, and much of it is locked into the system, and yet we still think of innovation as being very much a commercial world thing. So De Vries and Tummers and Becker, this is some academics from the Netherlands, they did some research last year to try and make a systematic review of what's happening in innovation in the public sector and what the future agenda might be. They came up with what they think are the key types. There are more. But innovation types are process innovation, that could be administrative or technical, technological, product innovation, service innovation, governance innovation, conceptual, and there was a large group of others where they couldn't categorise it. You'll be glad to know I'm almost at the end of it. So identifying who are the innovators, why innovators are different to non-innovators, are the systems in place to encourage innovation, are there incentives, who's going to own the innovation, do existing mechanisms facilitate knowledge exchange within the public sector, and the ability to draw information together. Well, obviously not, because of the hierarchy and the, you know, how knowledge gets transferred. Where are the blockages? If you're looking for innovative practice, you have to identify where the blockages are in terms of where you'll find the knowledge. And traditional project management tools are largely inadequate for measuring innovation. So innovation is very difficult, a bit like leadership, as to how you measure what it is and how you know that it's had an impact. So in the following two slides, and then I'm finished, a quick synopsis of the chapters of the book on public sector entrepreneur, just to show you the variety of public sector entrepreneurship. This is coming out in June, and it's just to show you how I think we're moving on from the traditional view of what we mean by innovation entrepreneurship. Okay, you just need to read the red stuff here. The first chapter is about how the state works with other agencies to create like what's called a service tank. In other words, the state is able to stimulate innovation between a whole range of different groups, commercial world, etc. The second one in Newcastle, Newcastle City Council is using sponsorship to try and do things differently. Now, not just sponsorship in terms of financial sponsorship, other ways of sponsorship. They're being very entrepreneurial. The next chapter is about how we need to understand that public servants are educated and trained in a different mindset to people working in the commercial world. We have notions of legality, common good, accountability, integrity, etc. I'm not saying that people who work in the private sector don't have these things, because I work myself in the private sector. Another chapter is about bricolage, bringing together scientific knowledge that's been developed in the academy. This is from Nigeria, this one actually. And looking at how local people are coming up with their own ideas on innovative practices and marrying the two together. This is called bricolage. Another one, Leicester City Council acted as an animateur, a regulator and an entrepreneur to use culture and heritage to build the infrastructure, to build the networks, to bring the private sector in. And they had the legitimacy, they had the accountability, and innovation in this case was a multifaceted and not just about individuals. It's about the public sector, the local government, etc. Glasgow City Council, one of the other ones, used the Commonwealth Games to reimagine what Glasgow could look like in 10 years' time. And the importance of this was they created innovation was used as a strategic long-term aim, and how they were leaving behind a legacy, research, return on investment. And the final three, this was Mike Rowe, actually, who I thought would be here tonight. Mike and Alan Southern have been doing lots of work on looking at what happens in communities. What does innovation mean in communities? And basically, what Alan, and I did have a quote from you, Alan, but I had too many slides and I had to get rid of it, but you were in there, darling. You were in there. But innovation can't be top down. Innovation must be bottom up if it's to be effective. That's what they were saying there. The next chapter, which is interesting, about rural public services. I don't know where it was in England, but it was this is Fergus Lyon. And he said that if you look at rural areas, innovation in rural areas is much more different to what we think of innovation, because it's based on collaboration and need to balance social and commercial values. So the kind of models of innovation we have from neoclassical liberal assumptions based on profit, based on perfect markets, homogeneity and competition, what they show in this chapter is it's completely different in a rural area, because doctors come together and collaborate, schools don't want to close, so they merge with other schools, so there's much more a collaborative element. And Julian, your time has come, dear. Julian looked at the fire and rescue service in the Northwest, and that's, again, that's an excellent chapter. And what you found, I think, is that because the fire and rescue service in the Northwest had a history of working on safety issues and community engagement, they then started to develop a very novel project to look at East Europeans coming in and trying to integrate them into communities. And the important thing for me out of that chapter was that they first of all had a novel solution, but secondly they had a legacy, but also they were very interested in working how far their authority level went. Would that be a fair analysis, Julian? That's my kind of synopsis of it. So those two slides are just saying to you there's a massive amount of it going on, but what we're not doing is capturing it, and what we're not doing is standing back and theorising what it means in a public sector context. So in summary, you'll be glad to know, yeah, I'm nearly on time, we need to think about a plurality of interrelationships between state, non-state and civic agencies, because the state is still the regulator and it still has legitimacy within places. It's diminishing every day, but still has. We have these outdated leadership models that have their, you know, they have validity, but the world is changing. I think we need to try and draw together management science models that are organisationally specific and individualised, try and merge them with social science methods if we can, models if we can. Existing in innovation and entrepreneurship is based on individuals and products. It's not about collectivity and collaborative processes. We need to start thinking more process. Urgent need to theorise these new relationships and develop methodologies and new categories. Many obstacles to innovation, obviously, in public services. You can't be innovative like you could if you're developing a product, because civil servants may not be, you know, particularly risk takers. There's this issue of power, accountability, who owns the innovation. And it's not like taking a patent out on a new product. And shared ownership, the issue of common good, the issue of public value, these are all things that we need to think about. And my plea is if we could try and move away from the theories and methodologies that were very valid, but they're kind of no longer in tune with the multi-complex realities of particularly, not just in the public sector, but in the how you shape places and how you lead innovation in places. And I think that might... Oh, final quote. Final quote from Klein. Public organisations are usefully analysed as entities that create and capture value in both the public and the private, as the public sector can act entrepreneurially by creating or leveraging bundles of capabilities to shape subsequent entrepreneurial action. And the cases I said about Leicester City Council, is it Leicester or Leicestershire? Leicester City Council, Newcastle City Council, Glasgow City Council, that's what they're doing. They're leveraging their capabilities. They don't have the capacity to deliver, so they can bring in other capacities. This involves very complex interactions among public and private actors, and it's a co-evolutionary process. So that's my plea, and I hope I haven't gone over too long, but I'm very happy to take questions, so thank you very much. Thank you. And I didn't sit down once, but I'm going to sit down now if you don't mind. Yeah.
Thank you very much. Yeah, perhaps anybody wants to volunteer to have, we've got some time for a few questions. Yeah, Julian.
Yeah, it's kind of a methodological question. I mean, there was a point in there in which I thought you were criticising case study methods. I mean, I think one of the interesting methodological questions is if you do case studies in similar looking but actually quite different circumstances, is how you actually compare or relate the results.
Yeah.
I don't have an answer to that, but I think it's an extremely important question given what you've been saying.
Yeah, I think that's really important, Julian, because what we've been doing in this group, you know, we've been coming together and we have a presentation from Australia, we'll have a presentation from Texas and what's happening in Finland. It's all very interesting. It's great. We like to. But, you know, when you look at the Finnish system, if you look at the Australian system, the political system, the social system, they're all very different. So you're not really comparing like with like. And you can draw out some important things that we think are interesting. But case studies are very valuable. Within a case study, you can do, you know, focus groups, you can do interviews, you can do all that kind of stuff as well. So I'm not saying we should get rid of case studies until we come up with something as an alternative. They do have their worth, but when you're moving to more comparative research across different states, you do question the worth of case studies, really. I mean, if you do work on fire and rescue service, sure, the fire and rescue, I mean, I used to teach at the fire service college in Morton Le Marsh, and you had people from the Highlands and Islands of Scotland. I had a guy from Hong Kong, and I got them talking about what were their key issues in leadership, because they're teaching leadership, and they were just like different worlds apart, you know. And then we had fire and rescue down in Cornwall and the Scilly Isles, and they were like, well, we have to go out with a boat and like whatever. And it was like the differences were amazing. So, yeah, I mean, I don't know whether that answers your question, but I'm not saying we should dump them. I'm just saying that, you know, we need to rethink other methods if we can.
Sure. Yeah?
Thank you. As a feminist interpretivist, I welcome your suggestions for new Good. Approaches, and I enjoyed your talk very much.
Thank you.
You may be interested to know, in fact you might find it difficult to believe, that I actually did a process innovation research consultancy project funded by the Institute for Local Governance with a big city council not far from where you come from. It has a famous football team and it begins with S, but I won't say any more.
This was through John Mawson's Institute of Local Governance, was it?
Yeah. And it was quite interesting because it was all about process innovation. They were trying to look at how they could... I mean, it was all within the idea of adding value, as you've talked about, and it was along the agenda of the resilient communities.
Yeah, yeah.
And it was how could they address their social care issues differently, because...
Yeah.
Social care, and particularly care of vulnerable adults, was taking something like 95% of their disposable income. So we went in, all bright-eyed and bushy-tailed. wanting to speak innovatively and entrepreneurially and so on. And it was very quickly apparent to me that absolutely everybody in the room was a blockage, because they all have a vested interest in none of that changing, because they lead the sections that provide the services and the support services and so on. So it was a very interesting sort of locked into that sort of circle. So it sort of struck me as you were talking, I was so interested in what you were saying, but how difficult the pressures in the public sector in particular, and particularly in council, to be innovative or entrepreneurial at all. With these blockages,
because you've always got the politics and the vested interests. But I think, in a way, what you're saying kind of confirms my point. There's a lot of innovation going on, but what we're not doing is capturing it. And what we're not doing is writing books on it. And what we're not doing is kind of writing articles in the academic world. I've taught countless senior managers in local government, civil servant, what have you. And I mean, Pete is a former senior civil servant, so I hope he'd sort of support me on this. But of course they're doing all sorts of innovative stuff. But what we're not doing is standing back, reflecting on it and saying, well, this is a really important body of work. And I think that by sticking with those models of, you know, the private sector, what leadership means, what innovation, that's all I'm saying. I don't have any of the answers to this at all. But I do think we need to start, you know, focusing our sort of, sort of putting the microscope a bit more on it, because the world is not going to change. And the way the societies are moving on now, as I say, use terrorism, use just today in Brussels, if you use, migrants and that kind of thing, those are becoming multifaceted problems that states alone can't solve. The private sector's not going to solve them, because there's no profit in that, is there really? So I think things are getting more and more complex, but I'll look your work out actually with John. It was a report. And that's another thing, you see, a lot of the work that happens on what's happening in local government and social care and what have you tends to be consultancy work, and then there's all sorts of provisos that they don't want you to publish it and get, you know. So yeah, it's fraught with, the problems I suggested here, you know, earlier. What did I say? Oh, it's gone. You know, why people, I can't remember what I said. I see all sorts of things. But anyway, so multitude of problems with capturing this kind of stuff in the public sector. But thanks for that.
You've got the leaders there, look at leadership. The leaders were keen to be more innovative and entrepreneurial.
Yeah.
But the structure, the processes, and
the people. That's right. Yeah. That's why I think, actually, with my public administration head on, I think structures, processes, and people, if we can kind of just try and focus on that kind of thing, and I don't know, build some theory or something. I don't know. I mean, I'm just thinking around it. Yeah.
Sure. John.
Okay. This is gonna. It's getting worse.
Do you want some water?
So following on from what Helen said.
Yeah.
The two slides I really liked.
Only two.
Only two.
Come on, John. How long have we been
Maybe
writing
three.
Together, dear? Oh, three. Okay.
Okay.
That's all right then.
Or the ones before this. So it's the slide where you said, "Who are the innovators? Why do?" What is it that makes people innovators?
Yeah.
And what is it that makes people not innovators? Interesting, the question in a sense you're raising. And then you went through the book.
Mm.
And I'm not saying it because it's him, it's Julian. But the point you drew out of that chapter was about the Fire and Rescue Service testing the level of their authority.
Yes. Yeah.
In other words, there was some challenge by themselves about what they could do.
Yes.
So it's like pushing the boundaries of their role.
Yes.
And out of that, it's either out of that or part of the innovation shapes that. So I'm wondering whether that's one of the things about innovation. Is it something to do with testing the levels of authority and not requiring permission, but choosing to
John,
act?
John, there's just flies in my head. I remember finding a little model of strategy when I used to teach strategy years ago called mandate analysis. It was written by R.J. Smith, 1996, if I remember rightly. And he said that what you have to do if you're a public manager is you have to say, what am I allowed to do? What am I prevented from doing? And the bit in the middle, he didn't say this, but I'm interpreting what he said, is that's where you get innovation and entrepreneurship, because there are legalities, there are, you know, if you're running a school, for example, you have to do certain legal things. But then there are certain things that you can kind of test your authority on. And it's that, it's the gap, the grey area, where you might have that potential to...
I understand that very, very quickly. The thing about the fire and rescue service in Cheshire that Julian writes about is that it seems to me completely counterintuitive.
Yes, yeah.
And to be working with the migrant community, to be working with home safety, to be working with the elderly, mm-hmm. is not what fire and rescue services do.
Yeah.
We think. So what is it about? Is it something to do with the people? Is it something to do with the organisational culture?
Yeah.
Is it something to do with the sense that they didn't feel they needed anybody's permission?
Yeah.
And therefore were willing to innovate until such point?
I use an example in my teaching about a big mental hospital up in the northeast of England, Morpeth. And to all intents and purposes, their work is about caring for mental health. But they have a big army base quite nearby called Otterburn. But because the Health Trust or whatever, they had a massive laundry capacity. But it wasn't being used like, you know, every day, da-da-da-da. So they decided to go into a partnership with the army camp so that they would do all their laundry for them. Now, again, whether that was innovative leaders or people who were looking at the process or whatever, they thought, well, we've got this laundry that we never use. Like another one in prison in Durham at the moment, they have a big canteen. They feed all the prisoners, lock them up, throw the keys away or whatever. But then they have this capacity. So they've decided to feed all the old people in the area for like £5 or whatever, you know, do what used to be done by Meals on Wheels. So I think they're kind of examples of what you're saying as to where is our authority level. And we'll do it until we get stopped from doing it, you know? So going back to what I was saying about the state, you know, there's a regulation, there's a legality, there's the accountability, but there are grey areas where people can, which I think Julian's case is a very good example of that. Maybe we need a bit more of that, yeah? But yeah, thanks, John.
Yeah, conscious of time, so maybe a quick last question. Alan.
Hi, Joyce, what do you think that those people in practice now in the public sector mean when they use the term public value?
Well, it depends whether they've read the books, Alan, or not. Well, what happens in public sector, as far as I can see, anyway, having been one and you know, worked with a lot of people, the next initiative will be along very soon, you know what I mean? So it might be that they just think, well, it's something else we have to tick a box on or something like that. That's a cynic in me saying that. But if you talk to people who work in the public sector, they really join the public sector, because let's face it, you don't get paid as much as your commercial counterpart, who really do believe that they want to improve the public good. They want to work in public services because of public good. So public value might be something that is embodied in what you mean by public good. But again, if I take it back to the slide that I said where Mark Moore had identified all the stakeholders, as we and you and I both know, Alan, you know, there are going to be conflicts between all these different agencies. And that's the essence of public services, that you're always dealing with finite resources, infinite demands, people trying to satisfy certain groups because you can't satisfy them all. But I think public value will be probably tied in with notion of public good, I think.
Isn't it a question of three things? There's an element of altruism there.
Yes.
So it's for other people, not for yourself.
Yes.
There is also an element of collective value as opposed to individual value.
Yeah.
You know, because of this, you know, Thatcher reaction to Thatcherism. Mm-hmm. And I've forgotten the third one now, so I shouldn't have said it. But I just wanted to come back. Paresh, am I all right?
Quick one, yeah.
To this business of, I definitely see, I definitely had the problem of heroic leadership when I was dealing with, under comprehensive performance
assessment,
when somebody failed, an authority failed or significantly underperformed, we intervened in them.
Yeah.
And we intervened in them, took them over. And there were 83 cases in my time in government. And what happened when you took over an authority, and I did 11, right? Mm-hmm. And I mentored the other people who were doing it. And I said to them, it's not about you, because these people who we got as lead officials usually had been chief execs from other places and been successful as a leader in another place. And they definitely came in with the concept that they were a heroic leader and they were going to do the same thing again.
Yeah.
And they often failed because they were trying to do in their new context what they did correctly in their old context. Yeah. And you had to mentor them and coach them to say, it isn't about you, it's basically a game of chess, you know, whereby you've got to get the different parts as actors and the complexities together.
Yeah.
But it's not a fair game of chess.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
You know, they're a local authority with all their powers. You're representing the government,
mm-hmm.
right? So it's almost like when I choose as the government to take away a grant from this local authority or to give a big, I can change the pieces on the board.
Of course.
So it's something about breaking through paradigms that are enclosed or I'm always, whether it's a problem or an opportunity, there's something that changes the parameter.
But yeah, I agree and I see where you're coming from. But whilst government still remains has the legitimacy as the regulator and as the measurer, you were going in and measuring, weren't you? You were measuring them and saying, well, your crap, so out you go. So there is something about, sorry, forgive my words there, but there's something about, you know, does the government still retain that role as regulator, being legitimate, etc.? Because I remember when you were in civil service then, but when the Blair government was in power, all this stuff about experimentation, and I want you up in the northeast to do something different to Cornwall and all that kind of thing. It's all very well saying be experimental, which is largely about what entrepreneurship's about, being more experimental. But then, you know, you knew that the book stopped there if you went beyond your authority level, which is what John was saying. So, yes, it isn't a kind of open-ended thing. You can't just say, open up the shackles and let people do whatever they like, while you are still state-funded. But given what you were saying, and we were having coffee earlier, if in a few years' time there's going to be no grant from local government at all, from central government at all for local government, then there can be as entrepreneurial as they like. They'll be bringing in money from the private sector, if there is any, or I think that's the theory behind that. Just let the market decide. But when the market decides, then the people at the bottom of the pile that were helped by the safety net, you know, don't get helped. But anyway, my political thing there. But yeah, thanks for that, Pete. Yeah.
Thanks, Pete. And I think we could go on this, but I think we need to make it to a close. So I think, thank you very much, George, for such an excellent presentation. I think I'm sure it has provoked a lot of thought process and I have a few questions, but I'll leave it for now. Can we thank her for, in our traditional way?